Hachette Children's Group presents Stories for Six-Year-Olds by Enid Blyton. Read for you by Heather Long and Joe Eyre.
The Bread and Milk. Binkle the kitten was very fussy one day. He turned up his nose at the nice dish of bread and milk that his owner put out for his breakfast. He wanted fish. "You shall have fish this afternoon," said his owner. "Now eat your breakfast up properly." But Binkle went away in a corner and sulked. The dish of bread and milk stood in the porch, full to the brim. Soon the robin spied it. Down he flew and chose a big piece of soaked bread. Four sparrows saw him and flew down to join him. The robin didn't like eating with other people, so off he flew, and the sparrows pulled pieces of bread about, eating a very good breakfast indeed. Other sparrows heard them chirruping happily and came to join them too. Then a small mouse peeped out of his hole in the bank not far off and sniffed with his little waffly nose. How good that bread and milk smelt, to be sure! He really must have a taste. Off he scampered and came to the dish. The sparrows flew off to have a dust bath and left the dish to the little brown mouse. He nibbled daintily here and there and wondered what made the bread taste so very delicious. What a fine breakfast he was having! A movement under the lavender bush that grew near the door startled him so much that he ran off in a hurry, thinking it might be Binkle the kitten hiding there. But it was only old Prickles the Hedgehog, who lived in the garden and ate beetles, slugs, and grubs whenever he could find them. He too had smelt the bread and milk and meant to have some. He ambled up to the dish, tipped it up so that he could drink the milk, and then began to feast. How he enjoyed it! Just then he heard the pattering of footsteps, and up came Bobs the dog. The hedgehog, who was not afraid of any animal in the world, walked back to the lavender bush and curled himself up there to go to sleep. Bobs knew him well and left him alone. He sniffed at the dish and licked it well all around. Now Binkle the kitten began to feel very hungry, and off he went to find his breakfast, thinking that bread and milk wasn't so bad after all. But when he came to the dish, it was empty. "We took some," said the robin and the sparrows cheekily.
"I ate some," said the little mouse, peeping out.
"I took some," said the prickly hedgehog, licking his lips. "And I licked the dish," said Bobs.
"You greedy things," cried Binkle in a rage. "It was my breakfast."
"And ours too," said everyone, and how they laughed.
The King of the Trains. Malcolm had a big red engine for his birthday. You should have seen it. It was the biggest toy engine he had ever seen. So big that Malcolm and his sister Janet could easily get into the back of it and sit there together. Malcolm had a rope tied round the red funnel, and he used to pull Janet round the garden in the engine. Then he would have his turn at riding, and Janet would pull. It was great fun. One day, a very strange thing happened. The children were in the garden and had squeezed themselves into the engine together. "I wish the engine would go off by itself and take us along," said Malcolm. Just as he said that, the children heard a sound in the distance, like the loud whistle of an engine. At once, their own engine gave a start, as though it had heard. Then, to the children's enormous surprise, it began to puff away down the garden path. Yes, it really puffed. Smoke came out of the funnel, and it went faster and faster down the path. It was a very strange and peculiar thing. "Oh, goodness," said Malcolm in astonishment. "Whatever's happening?" "Hadn't we better get out?" asked Janet. But the engine was now going much too fast for them to get out. It puffed and puffed and rattled along out of the gate and down the lane as fast as ever it could. As it went, it seemed to puff a sort of song, and Malcolm listened to see if he could hear what the words were. It seemed to him as if the engine were singing again and again, "I might be king, yes, I might be king, I might be king, yes, I might be king." "How funny," said Malcolm. "Whatever does it mean, Janet? I say, isn't this an adventure?" The engine tore on down the lane, and the two children clung tightly to the sides. At the bottom of the lane, they came to a small turning to the right, and the engine puffed up this. Janet and Malcolm were astonished. "I never knew there was a turning here before," said Janet. "Did you, Malcolm?" Malcolm didn't either. But there certainly was, for the engine tore on down the little path, rocking from side to side when stones came in its way. It went on, and at last came to a steep hill that rose up to a point. The children thought the engine was going to puff right up the hill, but it didn't. It ran up to a doorway, set deep into the hill, and whistled loudly three times. The door opened at once, and the engine ran in, taking the two children with it. As it went in, Malcolm heard a noise behind them, and he turned round. To his surprise, he saw three more engines behind him, one nearly as big as his own, and the others smaller. They all went down a long passage, chuffing and puffing. At last, they came to an enormous cave, and there, to the children's great astonishment, they saw hundreds of wooden engines, some painted red, some yellow, some blue, and some green. Some were small and some were very big. Malcolm thought his engine must be the biggest of all. A large red engine whistled for silence, and all the engines stopped chuffing and were still. Then, with a good deal of puffing and blowing, the big engine shouted to the others,
"The king of the wooden engines is dead," he puffed. "He was broken to pieces yesterday. Who is to be our king now?"
At once, all the engines puffed and snorted in excitement, and Malcolm's engine and two other very big ones made their way to the front.
"We are the biggest," they chuffed. "One of us must be king."
Then all the smaller engines rushed round them and whistled excitedly. Malcolm and Janet sat still in the cab of their engine and listened. It was almost exciting. They did hope their engine would be chosen for king.
"This one shall be our king," puffed the small engines,
and they surrounded Malcolm's engine.
"It is the biggest and brightest of all. Where is the paint pot?"
The big red engine whistled loudly, and a small elf rushed in with a pot of bright gold paint. In a flash, he had painted a little golden crown round the funnel of Malcolm's engine. Then all the engines whistled at the same time and puffed,
"We greet you, King! Long life to you!"
Malcolm's engine whistled back so loudly that the two children were nearly deafened. Then it put itself at the head of all the engines and began to make its way back to the door in the hillside. Out they all went, the big engine leading the way, puffing and panting a happy little song as it went.
"I'm the king of the wooden engines, I'm the king of the wooden engines."
You should have seen the sight as all the brightly painted engines wound their way down the path to the lane. They whistled and puffed merrily. None of them had any children in them except Malcolm's engine, and Malcolm couldn't help thinking how lucky it was that he and Janet had happened to be riding in his engine just when it had rushed off to be made king. At the end of the path, Malcolm's engine turned down the lane that led to their house. The other engines whistled goodbye and went the other way. Malcolm's engine rushed back to the garden and put itself in the very place from where it had started.
"Well," said Malcolm, as he helped Janet out, "that was an adventure. Fancy, Janet, we've got the king of all the engines. Aren't we grand?"
They still have that engine, You will know it by the little golden crown painted round the funnel.
Snapdragon Snippets.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.